Welcome to Stone Chapel United Methodist Church.
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 Adopted this 19th day of October and signed by all five commissioners.
Bye.
stand if able and join me in the call of celebration. We have gathered to celebrate the 240 years of Stone Chapel.
We stand in the Holy Commandments.
Looking back.
Looking forward.
Aware of one who has led us through our first 240 years.
And confident of God's leadership in time to come.
We have been brought to this spot through the willingness of countless people to be used by God.
It is appropriate to pause, to give thanks to the past, and to dedicate ourselves anew for the future.
Let us do so with gratitude and joy. Please join me in the hymn, Over a Thousand Tongues to Sing, found on page 57, verses 1 through 4 and 6.
Stones are laid for a new chapel in Pipe Creek, Maryland. The area known as Pipe Creek is an important hub of early Methodism in early America for preaching, conferencing, and camp meeting, and Bishop Asbury was a frequent visitor. The chapel, often referred to as Pipe Creek Chapel, was properly known as Strawbridge's Stone Chapel, being named in honor of the founder of the congregation who passed away 2 years before that stone chapel was built. Given the sometimes difficult relationship between Asbury and Strawbridge, it's perhaps no wonder that Asbury uses the descriptive words Pipe Creek Chapel in his journal rather than its proper name. Strawbridge's stone chapel was so called because it replaced a wooden frame chapel, which itself replaced the camp meeting class meeting that was once held around the nearby Strawbridge Oak, both of which are the property of Andrew Polson, the brother-in-law of John Evans, the first recorded American convert to Methodism. The stone chapel would be taken down and rebuilt with the same stones 2 times, resulting in the beautiful and historic building, which is today's Stone Chapel of the United Methodist Church. Home to one of the earliest groups of Methodism to meet in America, Stone Chapel is the archetypal example of the evolution of the Methodist meeting house, beginning as a house church in the Wesleyan model, and growing into the modern United Methodist Church. The congregation that is today known as Stone Chapel began its missional life in early 1763 as the second class meeting established in America by Robert Strawbridge. Strawbridge's first class met at various locations, first in his own home, and then in the homes of neighbors, including that of his landlord, John England. The first society eventually met in the Long Meeting House before settling for many years in the home of John Evans, one of the very first main converts. Andrew Polson was John Evans' brother-in-law, and a second class meeting was soon set up, organized in his home. But as relatively large as this home was for the area, the class meeting soon outgrew and grew so popular that it would not fit inside the house. When this happened, their meeting place evolved into a second form, which was common among Methodists, which is meeting outside under a tree. Not far from Polson's house was a large oak tree, 30 feet around at the base, and Robert moved the class meeting to the tree, which became famously known as the Strawbridge Oak. Having been a member of both the first and second class meetings, Polson was committed to seeing that the Methodist community in America should take firm root. And he donated land on the southeast corner of his farm so that a full-time chapel could be built. In 1780, a wood frame meeting house was constructed that was known as Polson's Chapel. The congregation must have thrived because only a few years later, in 1783, that frame meeting house was taken down and replaced with a chapel made of stone. It was called Strawbridge's Stone Chapel, but it quickly came to be called simply the Stone Chapel, and occasionally Pipe Creek Chapel. And on Sunday, August 20th, 1786, Francis Asbury, according to his journal, rode 20 miles to Pipe Creek Chapel and preached to a large congregation. The congregation would get larger still. In 1780, Asbury preached to a revival meeting nearby, and this resulted in a sudden increase in the size of Stone Chapel's attendance. So the chapel was rebuilt using the same stone, adding a gallery to accommodate additional worship. Two of the congregation's members, Jesse Durbin and Benjamin Bennett, were instrumental in accomplishing this rebuilding, and so their initials were memorialized in a stone tablet at the front of the building. By the time the stone chapel reached its 100th anniversary in 1883, it needed considerable structural repair, and the building was again taken down and rebuilt, and again using the same stone, but the gallery was removed. Meanwhile, the venerable Strawbridge Oak continued to stand not far away from what had been the Polson Farm. And in 1905, it succumbed to its age, and in 1907, its wood was harvested. A pulpit chair made from the oak was placed in the Stone Chapel Sanctuary at that time. Stone Chapel Methodist Episcopal Church, as it was renamed, continued to flourish into the 20th century. And in 1951, the parish hall, built of concrete with brick facing, was added to house the Sunday school and other activities. Across the street, the Stone Chapel Cemetery is the final resting place for many of its members. Because the Polson Farm was sold and resold, the headstones for the family burial ground were relocated here, although the remains themselves stayed with the property. The Stone Chapel is part of what is known as the Robert Strawbridge Cluster, a historic site of the General Commission on Archives and History, number 491, for those of you taking notes. There's a test later. It is an important milestone in the journey of Methodism in America, from house church to outdoor meeting, from wood frame to stone, from historic class meeting to modern United Methodist congregation. Stone Chapel embodies the history of Methodist meeting places. Today we celebrate 240 years that are etched in stone, but this house of God traces its roots back more than 250 years of history, the very beginnings of Methodism in America. And I would argue that Stone Chapel has its origins in the book of Genesis and the story of Jacob, who stood a stone on its end and called that place Bethel, our house of God.
Thanks be to God.
Oakland UMC in Temple Hills, and Zion UMC and Lexington Park, and Covenant Point, and Lakeside Cooperative Parish in Waldorf. The Journey of Faith Church and a new cross greater United Methodist congregation in Southern Maryland, and Wesley Freedom UMC in Eldersburg. His innovative spirit of renewal and revival also led him to serve as a Baltimore Washington Conference, the director of vibrant communities for several years, before being appointed as an assistant to the bishop. In addition to his pastoral work, Reverend Love has been deeply involved in various committees within the denomination. He has chaired the Baltimore Washington Conference and Board of Trustees and served as an executive and director of the Northeastern Jurisdictional and Multi-Ethnic Center for Ministry. And currently, he chaired Black Methodist for the Church Renewal. Levin Love is not only a dedicated minister, but also a noted preacher and teacher, and his ministry centers around transcending the difference that separate people, and ultimately striving to create a beloved community. Today, we are privileged to have him share his wisdom and faith with us.
Please join me in giving a warm welcome to Reverend Tony Love. To this great congregation of Stone Chapel United Methodist Church, to your pastor, to Pastor Eugene, to all of you who are my brothers and sisters, siblings in faith, grace and peace from God our Father, from our Lord and Savior, who is Jesus the Christ, be with you. And blessings and congratulations to you on this 240th anniversary of God being in your midst and God doing a great thing. I bring you greetings and I bring you regrets from our Episcopal leader, Bishop Latrell Winchester, who was unable to be with us, but invites you to pray for her and her. I invite your attention for the time that is mine to consider the scripture lesson that has been read out of Numbers. And for this moment, I invite you to center on the sermon title, From Promise to Provision. From Promise to Provision. A promise is defined as engagement to do or not to do something. Ground for expectation of excellence or success in the future. And biblically, the word promise denotes an assurance of some future act. Let me share with you on this afternoon, in the Bible, the book of Origins, Beginnings, Genesis. The writer tells us that God, in covenant with a man named Abram, who will become Abraham, God swore to Abram that he would become the father of many nations, and that his people would inherit a land, the land of Canaan. The land of Canaan was described by God as a land flowing with milk and honey. In other words, Bible scholars, we need to understand God swore unto a 75-year-old man that he was going to become a father. Father, a child, and become the father of many nations. And his people, his descendants, would possess a land flowing with milk and honey. You, like me, in hearing this text, you probably say, how crazy is that? How absurd it is. But I invite us to always remember, God swore unto Abram. God promised Abram a family and a land. And that is why to this day, what we refer to Canaan as, but the promised land. It was a blessed assurance in the future for Abram's kinfolk. Siblings in faith, despite the situation, current situations that present themselves, you and I who journey and travel in faith, we always need to understand that when God promises us something, when God promises us anything, a promise with God is a sure thing. The Bible declares that God is not a man that God should lie. God has never been the father of lies. That's Satan's role. That's Satan's job. But God's words are always trustworthy and true. If you're like me, as you travel, I like to read bumper stickers. Anybody else there? You like to be? What's on bumpers? Amen. Amen. There's a bumper sticker that reads, God said it, I believe it, that settles it. And in reality, I have journeyed in faith. Whether I or you and I, we believe it or not, if God said it, that settles it. When God makes a promise, it will come to pass. And so God made, not established the promise of land with Abram. And we come to find out in our scholarship as we read through the Bible, God who promised the land to Abram, we arrive at this moment when God is using Moses to further this promise. We drop down to the book of Numbers and we find out this promise is being kept even after more than 400 years have passed. And so I invite you in this sermon to kind of consider our first move is promise. The second move in our time of conversation, holy conversation, is there's a proposal. See, in the opening verses of Numbers chapter 13, we learn that God instructs Moses to gather one man of every tribe. 12 men are to go into the land of Canaan, the promised land, and spy on the land. They are to go there to investigate, to discover what the land is like. Who lives over there? Are they weak? Are they strong people? Are there few people? Are there many people? What are the towns like over there? Is the soil fertile or not? But also bring back some of the best fruit that the land provides. And Moses, being obedient unto God's word, he sends 12 men to explore the land of Canaan, the promised land. And after 40 days of exploration, the 12 return to Moses and God's people, the Israelites. The 12 report, the land over there, it does flow with milk and honey. Remember God's promise. The fruit over there is very good, but the people who inhabit the promised land, Canaan, they're powerful. And the cities over there, they're large and fortified. Caleb, one of the men who explored the promised land, Caleb remembers the promise and with confidence speaks up and announced, we should go up and take possession of the land for we can do it. The men start to refute Caleb's assessment. They cry out, we can't attack them. They are stronger than we are. The land over there, it devours those who live in it. These inhabitants are Nephilim, relatives of Anak. They are giants. Third move in the sermon. There's a promise. There was a proposal. And now we have Caleb and Joshua contend that the Israelites can go and take Canaan, but the others say, not so. They present a roadblock in their pathway. They talk about an obstacle being before God's people. There's a problem, declares the majority. I just pause here and remind us, sometimes you can't go with the majority. You've got to hang out with the faithful few who will hold on to God's. Let me suggest to you that this problem is closely related to what I would offer you as a fourth move in this preaching moment, and that is perception. Let me invite you, carefully look at verse 33 of Numbers 13. In the latter part of the verse, it reads this way, we seem as or like grasshoppers in our own eyes, and we look the same to them. The problem of these giants is tied to perception.
Most of the men on the exploration, they were satisfied with their assessment. We seemed like grasshoppers and looked the same to them. But obviously it is Caleb who perceived the reality differently. There are two things, two peculiarities I would invite you to look at this problem and perception of the men who gave the bad report about the promised land. Hear this, beloved. First, you may clearly define how you seem in your own eyes, but you cannot readily assume to know how you look in someone else's. And secondly, note Caleb's perception. I believe Caleb saw the same people, saw the same land, saw the same situation as the others, but Caleb saw it differently. You see, Caleb saw the inhabitants, saw the giants, not as landowners, but as tenants. Not as those who were going to permanently possess, but those who were temporarily occupying. Caleb saw them in the caretaking business, not as settlers. Saw them as having custodianship of what belonged to others. Caleb saw them, saw those folk as simply holding on to the stuff that belonged to Caleb and God's people. They were simply taking care of it until God's people showed up. In other words, the Nephilim, the relatives of the giants, were simply in the babysitting business, holding on to the things that God had promised them, maintaining them until the appointed time of their arrival. I believe. I suggest to you, Caleb's perception is rooted in its base of the fact. Caleb walked by faith and not by sight. Which leads me to my last move. Provision. From promise to provision. Caleb realized, and I hope, Stone Chapel, you realize, celebrating 240 years, maybe 250 years, or even more, I hope you realize that God does not make a promise. God never gives a command. God never gives direction. God never gives vision without also making provision. God had already gone ahead of Caleb and Joshua. God had already gone ahead of Moses and Aaron. God had already gone ahead of Abram and Sarah. God had seen the future, made a plan to provide in the future before God made the promise, so that when the time came, the promise could be fulfilled by the provision, regardless of any problem or any problem with perception. That's why Caleb says, we can go up and take possession of the land. Certainly, we can do this. Caleb understood God promised this to us. It is ours. God will provide. The hymn writer wrote these words. All I have needed, God's hand has provided. Great is thy faithfulness, Lord, unto me. Stone Chapel, as you are celebrating this anniversary, this celebration, you have been, and those who have gone on before you, you have been on a journey, one of, from promise to provision. As you even continue to seek and expand and build and enhance your outreach ministries and your witness. And I come this day to declare and remind you, do not allow any proposal to frighten you. Do not allow any problems to stop you. Don't allow any perceptions to hinder you. Stay committed and focused on the fact that God who makes promises is a God who also makes provision. As God has provided for 240 years, God will provide. I leave you with this. Stone Chapel, pastor and people, God has not brought you this far to fail you. God has not brought you this far to leave you. God has not brought you this far to forsake you. God has not brought you this far to forget you. God has not brought you this far to give up on you, give out of you, give out on you, or let loose of you. But God has brought you this far because God is faithful. God is a promise maker. God is a promise keeper. And as God has been moving you from promise to provision for 240 years, may God continue to place promises in you. Amen. And if you will have the faith to hold on, God will also give you every provision. In Jesus' name.
I was baptized in this church by Reverend John Wunderlich. I was confirmed in this church by Reverend Al Lane, and I was invited in this church by Reverend Michael Bynum to preach my very first sermon. And it was in this church that I received my call from God. And I don't stand here today mentioning these names lightly. I mention these names because as I was thinking about looking to the future, I couldn't help but look to my past. And as I think about what today means for us as members of this community of faith, I was reminded of the words of Bishop Weaver, who spoke at our ordination service this year at Anglo Conference. And in his sermon, he talked about the significance and the importance and the power that names hold for us. Names like Matthew and Peter and John and Paul, names like Abraham and Moses and Solomon and David. And he said that sometimes it's easy for us to forget our names and to think of ourselves as pastor or reverend or doctor or teacher or dad or grandma. But those aren't our names. Our names, our real names, are the names that we put on at our baptism and the ones that name us child of God. And it made me also think of other names from my life. Names like Carol and Anna Mae and Bertha and Lee and Ann and John and Jackie and Terry and Sue and so many other names that I would love to lift up, but I only have 5 minutes. Names of saints in this church who were also called by Christ to be living demonstrations of what the love of God looks like. People who answered the hard questions of faith that a slightly mischievous Sunday school kid loved to ask, and who taught about love and discipleship and how to answer a call that God places on your life. People who build their house and their faith upon the rock of Christ. Because of all of these names, there is one name that stands above, the name of Jesus Christ, the one who came to love and to save and to call us each out of our pews and out of our churches and out of our comfort zones and out into creation to be in relationship with all the world and everyone in it. And in his ordination message, Bishop Weaver also reminded us about the words in the Wesley Covenant Prayer. I am no longer my own, but thine. A prayer that is so appropriate as we sit in this space today and celebrate the rich Wesleyan heritage that brought us here. And a little further on in that prayer, it says, let me be employed by thee or laid aside by thee. And as I hear these words, I wonder how many of us today are employed by Christ. How many of us celebrate the next 240 years? How many of us in this space today will have names that are called out in those next 240 years and beyond? Who will teach curious Sunday school kids how to engage with their faith and answer God's call? Who will be living examples of Christ's love to everyone in this world? Friends, I hope that it is all of our names, because what a beautiful world that would look like. And as I finish today, I encourage you to think about your name, the one that you put on in baptism, the one that names you child of God, child of love. And I challenge you to live fully into that and speak it into the next generation of curious Sunday school kids who just might hear a call from God. Amen. Amen.
God, we thank you for calling us to this sacred space. A house of prayer where praise and worship and proclamation for 240 plus years has gone forth. Thank you for the blessed assurance and for this day that you have made. Not only are we rejoicing and gladdened, but we can celebrate your faithfulness. But now, God, the time comes and we ask for your blessing. Give us your benediction. Send us forth that they may see the church on the move. Showing up in places where there's need for healing and restoration, for grace, and for reconciliation. We thank you for gathering us in this place that we may have fellowship with you and with each other. But now dismiss us that wherever we show up, we may be ambassadors of the kingdom. And they may know that you are alive and well, and the church is too. This is the prayer we ask in faith. We ask it in the name of your Son, our Savior. I ask it in the only name I know to guarantee the answer. In Jesus' name, send us forth. And the people of God said,
Amen.
Have everybody go out and assemble in front of the church, just like we've done in years and years past, and take a picture outside. Everyone here, please.